Hello, Toastmasters and distinguished guests. Who of you know what this rusty metal thing is? Please raise your hand. Quite cool. So I was approaching it slowly. When it came to it closer and closer with a survey measure in my hand, it started beeping and blinking like. When I came up close to this thing, actually, what I found out is that the amount of radiation there is quite on a dangerous level. I have had a cold shiver up my spine. A voice in my head told me, Alexei, you need to get out of here real quick. This is actually a piece of crane claw, which was used 32 years ago on the nuclear power plant, Chernobyl nuclear power plant site to evacuate, to remove highly radioactive debris from the site. Just 2 days ago, Ukraine and the whole world society commemorated the date of that horrible disaster. Just in one night, instantly, this tragic event crashed lives of so many people. I was born in 1986, and the topic of radioactive contamination followed me throughout my childhood. I remember one time I was playing outside with my friend. We were playing snowballs. And I was ready to pick a snowball and to put it to my mouth. And he said, what are you doing? You don't want to put this thing in your mouth. This can be radioactive. So I took this piece of snowball to my father, who is a doctor, just to check out. And he said, boy, if that piece of snowball was really dangerous, then our hot and cold running water, as well as your cup of tea and probably your clothes would be as dangerous as well. So you don't have to worry, and actually you can enjoy your snowball. And I did. Many years after the accident, a few years after the accident, almost on every kitchen in Kyiv, people shared with themselves, with each other, myths and scary stories about the highly radioactive zone, 30 kilometers zone around the Chernobyl site. One of the myths is that the zone is produced, created monsters, and there are highly mutated creatures who inhabit the zone. And there were still, to the date, there are a lot of myths like that. So I set out to the zone myself to make a first-hand research and to see it with my own eyes. And the first thing that I met was this little fox. Actually, we didn't, in my group, we didn't find any mutation in this creature except this unusual courage that she came up to us. Scientists, many researchers have proven that wildlife regenerated after the nuclear power plant disaster in this site. The absence of human activities led to the situation when many species of animals not seen in decades, they're returned to this area. Of course, a few years after the accident, there was a significant drop in birth rates in mammals, and some rivers and lakes are still highly contaminated in the area. However, nature and wildlife feels really good in this place. The only site that seems to be genetically changed and suffer from mutations is the so-called red forest. It suffered from radioactive rain, the fallout, and was completely destroyed. But then it regenerated. Now it has some morphological changes. Another myth is that actually the nuclear power plant disaster had a long-lasting health consequences for the whole world society. Basically, there are three groups of people who suffered, who were weak victims of this accident. The first one is the people who received acute amounts of radiation. Actually, these are 2,000 people, staff and cleanup workers, and unfortunately, 50 of them died really quickly after the accident. Another group of people are people who lived on the contaminated zones, and they received substantial amounts of radiation. These people are highly affected by population, and the figures on the victims are quite controversial. There are governmental figures and figures by independent researchers. So it is reported that there were from 6,000 to 270,000 cases of cancer, and as well from 62,000 to 93,000 cases of death. Apart from that, the general population, according to multiple researchers, is not likely to have long-lasting health effects due to the disaster. Another myth is that the zone is closed and inhabited, and is nobody lives there. Actually, this is also not true, as long as tourism is highly developed in the area. About 50,000 people visited the zone last year. There are around 3,000 workers in the zone, and some people also are called self-settlers, that are people who live in the zone without any permission. But the zone is still closed and unsafe to live long term. This is me standing on the rooftop, so I made it as an evidence. And actually, the zone can be visited if you would like to. In case you know what places to go to and what places to avoid. Places like this one. Now I think you know that the zone is not that scary, and probably one day you would like to go there and see it. And all nice. Thank you.
Wasn't there quite a long time preparing for the marathon. Now it's done, and now I'm here. And what I wanted to say is that we are all unique. We all have our own story. Sometimes fun and good, sometimes sad. Every day we face new challenges. Every day we try to solve a new problem. However, despite the fact that we are all different, problems that we usually try to solve, in general, quite similar. Or to speak more correctly, the roots or the causes of these problems quite similar. Not enough time and not enough money. Of course, some of you might say, "Ah, Dima, I have completely another problem. You don't understand. She simply doesn't love me." Or, "I've married an idiot and I don't know why." And of course, it could be. But if we speak about daily routine, about our daily problems, it's all about time and money. Not enough money to renew your apartment, not enough money to buy a new car, not enough money to fly to some nice place where you dream about. Not enough time to fly to this place. Not enough time for hobbies, for visiting parents, for do all your work in time. Today I want to tell you about one technique that helps me manage my time. I've been using it for a couple of months and it significantly improved my daily work. And the great part of these techniques that it comes for free. You do not need to invest any money or time into it. It's not like with going to sports or gym when you need to buy this monthly pass or something else, and then you need to find a time slot in your schedule which already overbooked with a lot of things. No, with these techniques it's a pure benefit. No additional time and money needed. Sounds like a magic. It is. I want to tell you about the Pomodoro techniques, the brilliant time management methods. It was invented by Italian student Francesco Cirillo, if I'm not mistaken. And it's quite simple. You split your work in time intervals. The recommended time is like 25 minutes, and then you have a short break between each interval. This interval is named Pomodoro, because the timer that Francesco used initially was this timer for cooking from kitchen that was like a tomato. That's why it's a Pomodoro technique. For the first look, it might appear like there's nothing different from what you do today. But if we made one step back and try to analyze our daily routines, we'll understand that it's quite different. How many of you have this feeling that you like a squirrel in the wheels? ID. You jump from task to task. Phone calls, mails, your colleagues interrupt you and ask for help. Your boss reminds you about the report you promised to do. Nothing is under your control. And then, at the end of the day, you feel totally exhausted, while there is a huge amount of unfinished work on your table. Actually, if you try to analyze and go deeper, you will see that only 3 or maybe 4 at maximum hours you use as an effective work. All the rest is all these interruptions switching between task and other ways. And here's the Pomodoro technique that helps you. You start your day with a simple creating a list of tasks that you are going to accomplish today. And this is a place where actually control starts, because you can easily estimate amount of tasks and amount of this Pomodoro timer intervals you need to spend to accomplish all these tasks. I usually do it when I have my morning coffee. Check my mails, create this list, some calls, talks with the colleagues, and so on. And then I have one session, 4 intervals, 25 minutes all, with 5 minutes breaks. It's 2 hours of extremely effective and productive work. Then you need to do a long break. As usually, I'll go for lunch. After I'm back, I have a time for some unplanned work, colleagues, mails, some other stuff, and then again, one more session of 4 intervals, 25 minutes with 5 minutes breaks. 2 more productive hours. This is a 4 hours in total. And for these 4 hours, you will be able to do all your job that you currently do for the whole day. So do I. Now you can ask me, but what about these interruptions? Where do they go? When you will start, you will see that they actually disappear. The only thing you need is just a little bit more discipline. Because actually any mails or calls could wait until the next 5 minutes break. Because you can use it not only for taking another one coffee, but also to answer these calls. Your colleagues, they know that you working in this Pomodoro technique, they wouldn't interrupt you. Your boss, if he or she is not an idiot, she or he will actually be interested in your work efficiently, effectively, and also wouldn't interrupt you. It's worked for me, it's worked for a lot of my colleagues, and it will work for you guys. So what I wanted that you do, guys, is that you take your mobile phones, go to App Store or Google Market or whatever, found a free app for these Pomodoro techniques, and believe me, there's dozens of such. Download it, read some more good advice how to use it, and start use it on the next Monday, and you will see how simple and great it is. Thank you.
And this is a tough call, because nowadays definitely there is no deficit in motivational speeches and inspiring videos and uplifting blogs, all these sort of things, and this day you can be just randomly surfing the web and get accidentally inspired. So I try to turn to my idol, whom I build a small temple with an altar in my apartment, and now and then sacrifice a god. And this guy, you know, his name is Melon Husk. And you know, he recently tweeted that he ate 3 eggs for breakfast, and millions retweeted, and then articles started popping up that he is so successful and rich and all that stuff because he eats eggs on a breakfast. And as all these articles and motivational blogs cannot manipulate you, no. You'd rather jump from your seats and go eat bread, eat eggs. I guess they have it, because you understand, if you want to be this billionaire and athlete and man without the flaws as Mellon Musk is, and you'd rather do it, right? Is it next?
Yeah.
You don't like Mellon Musk, don't you?
No, I'm afraid I've not understood the name. It's a proper name, but I'll come to that as a name.
All right, so I see Mike is not inspired yet. So let's go to the hard science. The hard science, I recently recall one guy, and he's a real scientist and very tireless one. He was hanging on the nightclubs and striptease bars in Texas and was researching lap dancers. So he was very diligently recording their period of cycle and whether they were smiling or not, and how all the things, how they correlated to the number of tips they received, to the amount of tips they received. So I think the story is inspiring in itself. So instead of cutting rodents apart, he was doing an interesting job all the time, surrounded by ovulating lab dancers. And I think he found something that during ovulation they receive more money, during the period they receive less. And if we can imagine any career is form of a lab dancing, I think we can use this, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Great. And you're still not inspired, which is probably my fault. And I guess it was sort of an irony to explain the problem I see in many this motivational, inspirational bullshit you were surrounded with. And the main problem is that it doesn't work very well, especially when you are getting older and more cynical. And if you're 19-year-old, then probably it helps, because it can give you a couple of common sense advices like sleeping more is better than sleeping less, eating healthy is better than eating a crap, and so all these sort of things. But by the time you're in mid-30s, it's sort of already clear to you. And all the speeches, they are either too pathetic, like everything is decided by you, what is decided for you, or they are sort of primitive, like, oh, I was so miserable and now look at me, or they are sort of use this science for housewives type of research, which with like this self-ovulating lab dancers research, or most irritating, they cultivate and support false beliefs, number of different false beliefs, one of which is that if you mimic someone, then you can become this someone. It's sort of a cargo cult. Or false beliefs that only if you are like intelligent and diligent and tall and handsome, macho, with all this impeccable moral principles, you will achieve conventional success. And if you are like lame and crooked and lazy and ugly and all these sort of things, you won't achieve this conventional success in terms of money or power and influence, which we all know is completely not true. It doesn't matter. So either way, you can be successful. So people put forward the case of Warren Buffett rather than case of Aristotle Onassis, who was leading his business empire from a nightclub 1 hour a day and spent all the time persuading women. Yeah. was quite a successful guy, again, in conventional terms. But still we need some motivation. And what I found, and I share a couple with you, just a couple, although I have more, because they are sort of interrelated. The two things I found for myself are philosophy and legacy of my family, let's call it like this. And unfortunately, we, in Ukraine, we don't have a luxury of good education, and if we had it, we would use it. All the humanities studies we have are sort of a reflection over what was once said in times of antiquity. And for example, Stoics are popular today because they also lived in a time of uncertainty, and they had this. The people were left to their own devices. There were no any big sense, for, and everyone had to decide how to structure his life. And they provided a couple of very useful techniques, useful for us as well, like reflect on your death, imagine the world without loved ones, and then after you imagine it, appreciate what you have at this point in time. And main thing is to don't worry about something you cannot control, worry only about the things you can control. And that's it. So very simple, very useful, you can use it every day. And it is somehow related, and I find it related to stories I had in my family. And one story I wanted to share with you is the story of my great-grandmother. And I think she lived a very complicated life. Not unfamiliar to Ukrainians. She lost all her properties and assets twice in her life. She lived through two hyperinflations, two big famines, two world wars. What else? I think in general the living of Ukrainian peasants in that years was essentially part of a big gulag. They were essentially living in labor camp, without rights, without passports. They were working like 16 hours working days without. The only difference, they would just come back to sleep at home and the next morning go back. And what is astonishing is not that it is so complicated, but it is very typical as well. I think if I call in this audience, a third of people say, I heard the story already. My great-grandmother had it too. I think it's sort of something we had all in Ukraine. And what she learned, and she was a truly stoic person. I cannot call her an intellectual because she was illiterate. She could not read. Her husband could read, but he was in prison because he was a religious guy and then sent to Far East, and again he's returned just in 15 years back home. And despite this, she was really wise. And she brought me up a little bit. She died when I was 11. And because of this, I learned to distinguish these two things, that there are people knowledgeable, like intelligent, and there are people who are wise. And my great-grandmother, she was wise. She preferred to keep silence, but if she spoke, she was always on point. And she was always skeptical about any government institution and all this stuff. But she was also very indulgent, because she understands the like true nature of people because of this hard life she went through. And when she was asked, like, why do you speak to your neighbors? They stolen your potatoes during the famine, and they accused their own father and did a terrible thing. And she told, don't judge them. You don't understand the spirit of the time we all were living in. So it's sort of a sign of wisdom when I started thinking this way. And I think my great grandmother is the person you can dedicate the whole speech to. But what I wanted to say is that When I recall in Hyok sitting on a bench in front of this yard during her last years, and I recall her life full of dignity and integrity and this true stoicism, it's sort of inspiring for me. I recall her frequently, and it is really inspiring. So, as a conclusion, I give you two sources of inspiration. You can take there are much more, of course, and use my advice for your benefit.
Stories like that. That's the story of Oksana's mother, grandmother, and great-grandmother. Great-grandmother lived to 99. Grandmother just died at 95. And these were strong people. One of your favorite authors is Talib, who has a wonderful expression, intellectual yet idiot. And that is the leadership of America today, intellectual yet idiot. That's what I like about Ukraine, is people who have wisdom, not the intellectual credentials. Well, speaking of wisdom, here's a gentleman among us who will get more, because I asked him to tell me how to introduce himself, and he didn't do it. Would give me a free rein to say whatever I want about him, and that's dangerous. You shouldn't do that. You'll know better next time. This is a guy who I think was brought up in a Toastmasters crib. He's been learning English since he was yo-hai, but unlike most people whose fathers have great expectations for him, he seems to be coming through, and Dad's pretty proud. So let me introduce Nazare, our Table Topics Master. Nazare.
So, hello everybody. As you understood already, I am the Table Topic Master today. And I promise you, you will suffer. Really. Okay, so if you didn't know how it works, then a table topic session is like this. I tell you what topic do you speak about, or a question, or whatever. And then you come out and you have limited time, of course. How can you be without limited time? You have limited time to answer that question or speak on that topic. And as always, remember, you have your speech, even though it's much shorter than prepared speeches, it has to have an opening, body, and conclusion. And don't forget to use the word of the day, close. So, let's begin. It all started today in the morning. I was just reading a book, just reading a regular book. Then I found a word that was like, literally, it was like a tongue twister. Number one, I didn't know the meaning of that word. Number two, I couldn't even pronounce it right. So, as always, I got my phone and I googled this word. But there was nothing there. Really? There were some weird sites that didn't tell me the exact meaning of this word. And I suffered. I definitely suffered. Trying to figure out what that word meant, which was impossible. And then, hopeless, was trying to scroll even deeper into Google. And finally, yes, I found it. And the meaning was completely different from what I thought it was. So I suffered in the morning, and you will suffer today. So, I will tell you a word that almost no people know. It's the really weird words. And then you will try to tell what you think this word means. Be free to tell whatever you think. You might guess, who knows. So let's move on to our first word. Our first word is symbol. Spelled like this, and I will call to the stage to explain what symbol means. Yelena.
Me?
Yes.
Symbol. Of course, I don't know the meaning of this word, so I have to imagine, yeah? If we are not sure, just try to make
symbol of something. Of course it's not. It looks like a sympathetic. No. Any idea I can find with symbol and symbol and symbol? I have no idea. It means that you know that young boy who wanted ours to suffer. I thought that he was joking. But he was not. Because I'm trying to use all my wit and all my, I don't know, memory, try to find something in my mind, but I don't have even an idea what, how to explain it. Symbol. Maybe it's a kind of flower. Is it? No. But maybe it looks like. Let it be a kind of flower. I will even describe you. For me, it's a red one. It smells perfectly when you come to the place where symbols are. You start to feel such great feelings. You are amazed. You enjoy that fresh smell. And you like it. Very, very much. Okay, let it be a flower. Thank you very much.
Is a musical instrument.
Oh my god.
What? The trans-
musical instrument. Oh.
Yeah, it's a musical instrument. And
how this instrument? Symbolic.
Okay, symbolic, yes. Symbolic. It's right, symbolic.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Now, our next word will be Ribazuba. I'm not joking, this is a real word. I didn't make it up. I'm not kidding. Really, Ribazuba. And who will be our volunteer? Who will speak? You, please.
We have to say your applause because really, if I can emulate Helena there and sort of speculate on my feet. But you have a funny word for fish in the Ukrainian or Russian. And I'd like to suggest that this rubella is actually a fish disease. Now you may think fish disease is rather, you think, do fishes have disease? Well, yes, they do. And as fishing being one of the staple forms of cultivation we have in the UK, after all, we are surrounded with quite a lot of water, and we've had political troubles because too many people come and pinch what we think are our fish. We do actually have a lot of very clever scientists, like Victor there, but then instead of studying things which buzz around, they actually take a lot of interest in the various diseases, and there are numerous such diseases, because I have actually, when I've been in Plymouth, in the southwest of England, I've happened to find myself past there, and you pass this laboratory, and almost engraved in stone, there's a list of fish diseases. So there you are, you will not now, Dr. Pass, through Kiev without holding your head high and saying, aha, what, madam, do you know about fish diseases?
Okay, so, yeah, I knew you. Anybody who would answer this question would think that it's something to do with fish. But has almost nothing to do with fish. I might even say nothing. Okay, the real meaning of the word Ribazuba is an ivory of a walrus.
Wow.
Yes.
Well.
Nobody would think it would be that.
A marine animal.
Yeah. Okay, now is Gentacula. The next word. And it will go to Dmytro? Yes, you.
on my work, I'm working in IT industry, on my work a lot of people now start to propaganda all these agile ideas, agile manifests that we should be, like, there's 2 points, inspect and adapt. So you need to revisit what you already done and then adapt what you are doing, and there will be improvement, improvement, improvement. For me it's actually strange because I always used to work like you need to adapt to the reality and change everything if it's needed. And but for some reason they think that it's kind of a religion, and sometimes it becomes more stupid, I don't know. But in any case, inspect and adapt, it for now, it's the main idea of my company. Sometimes it's really stupid and I don't understand. But it's very useful. It's very useful because I think you, a young boy, because you were struggling tomorrow morning, oh yes, today morning, sorry, you made a mistake. And actually this waltz has a... Yes, so if you will see, it's a spectacular. Impossible is nothing. We shouldn't be changed because of obstacles. We should change the obstacles. Thank you.
Oh my God.
Well, thank you.
Well,
what would it mean? It could mean actually everything, because morally, maybe we can like, maybe we like to walk, maybe we like to have wrong walks, and maybe some of them like to use drugs. So what a drug, actually it could be like interesting drug, or maybe we can be addicted to something, like reading a book, spending money, or maybe attaining money, maybe working hard. So we can just discover the new drug for us, like water drug. So we can name it as we wish. But what I say, it looks me like it could be something like heart, something like maybe connected with road, or maybe something connected actually with what we like. Because we may like many things, but I was not thinking that what a drug, it would be meaning like something, like be only one meaning. But who knows, maybe the real answer we would find out a little bit later. But anyway, thank you for this wonderful word. I think I will remember it.
For me to tell the real meaning of the word woolly drag. So, woolly drag means a useless person.
Say again?
A useless person.
A useless person.
Mm-hmm. Okay. As always, our native and tongue twister word will be blatherskite. Okay, who wishes to speak about the blatherskite? You, please?
Yes.
Timur.
Blatherskite, I think it's related to what you said, Mike, about the clothes.
Yeah.
Blatherskite. Something, the same pronunciation, maybe. You know, once my friend and I played a game. We gave each other very weird English words, which each of us knew, and the other one had to guess what this word meant. But it was like a duel, because if he guesses, if he, not guesses, but if he knows actually what this word means, then he wins, and it was good for developing vocabulary. I'm doubting that I will remember any of these meanings, because it's too difficult. For me, my brain doesn't work so fast. But let me guess what blatherskite can mean. Skite is similar to kite, maybe. Kite that flies in the sky. A blather, it's almost like brother. Blather, yeah, chattering, yeah, thank you. Blather is maybe chattering, yeah, speaking. Letterskited, maybe it's a person who talks a lot. Yeah? And let's think it's the meaning, so I must say something about this. You know, public speakers should talk a lot. But should talk correctly and should talk in an interesting manner. And if you are here, it's an advice for you.
English,
my friend. If you came here, just speak and say something. And try to make it interesting. And be sure that whatever you say, with energy in your heart, it will be interesting for people. Even if you look at this sheet of paper, and there will be something on your face that shows that there are emotions inside, it will be interesting for the audience. Will it be?
For sure. I'm really surprised to say that you almost guessed correct.
It was a hint from the audience.
Letterskite is a person who really talks a lot, but doesn't make much sense. Maybe another one, weird one. I'm even running out of words how to express myself. Our last word will be nerdle. Who wants to speak to the audience? What is nerdle?